Good morning. As you, for those of you who have arrived early, we just want to flag that your income tax receipts are here at the corner if any wish to pick them up before the service. You're certainly welcome to pick them up after as well. They're in alphabetical order for you.
Test. Good morning. Yeah, good. Thank you so much. And do you know where the clicker is?
It's hard to take it seriously.
I know. Do you have?
I'm waiting for here, waiting for my head.
Okay. So what I do?
Good morning. My name is Tammy Lindahl, and I'm the Minister of Spiritual Care here at First Metropolitan. I have two candles this morning in memory of Margaret Cunningham and Ruth Mannix. Our prayers are with their family for support and care, and We remember them as longtime members of this congregation who have contributed so much over the years. I light in memory.
Good morning. Friends, we had a wonderful celebration as we focused on listening to our bodies and giving thanks for the ministry of Emily McDonald last week. There was one item, a video clip, that didn't quite appear last week, so we wanted to make sure you got to see it now. You recognize Linda? She's now living in Halifax, and Linda Hallett has been such a key part of the life of our congregation, especially in the wellness ministry. Let's hear from Linda. And Linda is going to be the nurse going with our youth to Cuba in March. So she's going to rendezvous in Cuba with us. So we'll no doubt have more news from her at that time. Friends, we also are getting a reputation for being the Church of the Holy Fork. We had our family fun Friday, having a wonderful meal. The men's group, they gather for lunch this Tuesday, and if you came in the other way, you smelled that wonderful chili that's getting ready. And our thanks to the West Shore Cobbs store, who have donated some very delicious buns to go along with it. And so do join us after the service for that as part of our Mardi Gras celebration. But we're going to eat again on Tuesday evening. And we have, Kelly has brought a bit of music to mark the occasion. I think we have the words to show with you too. This is by Herb O'Driscoll. It's a hymn in praise of the humble pancake.
And we're all going to sing it. It's just three verses. If you want to sing the entire hymn in praise of the humble pancake, come to the Shrove Supper on Tuesday. There's even funnier verses, but you'll recognize the tune. It's a very, very straightforward tune.
Yes?
Yep. That's the tune. So we're all going to stand and sing this very interesting and holy hymn.
Thank you.
verse 3. Excellent.
Well, that's a fine follow-up to listening to your body last week. But note, we're getting ready for Lent when the tradition is not to have pancakes or other such things. And so this is our last Sunday of the season of Epiphany, Sunday of Transfiguration. And so when we begin in our worship, you'll hear images of the mountaintop. We want to note, tomorrow is a holiday and it's a long weekend, so we're missing some of our regular folk traveling. But even though it's a holiday, we're going to start our short Jazz Alive series that's on every Monday at 7 to 8, featuring some leading musicians in town, jazz pop musicians. So 7 to 8, and it's a great opportunity. Join us if you're able. There's more announcements in your bulletin. On Tuesday, as we noted, Trove Tuesday Supper runs from 5:30 to 6:45. At 6:45 here in the sanctuary, all who would like to join us, we have a short 10-minute ceremony of the ashes. We don't offer that on Ash Wednesday. People have gathered on the Tuesday evening, and so we have the ceremony that evening, recognizing that three-quarters of the world already has moved into Ash Wednesday. So we have that ceremony at that time. There are also a couple of sessions for those who would like to take level one or level two of the new chapter of your life. You'll see information in your bulletin. And next Sunday, we are delighted that Don Evans is our guest preacher, bringing the message based on his work as the executive director of Our Place. So please spread that word around to others. People won't want to miss that. Now we have an introduction of some music.
We do indeed. In you there is a refuge. Sounds like this. We can stay seated after three. One, two, three. In you there is a refuge. In you we find our peace. When all we know is chaos, may our trust in you increase. In you there is a silence. In you our minds are clear. When all we hear is discord, may your quiet draw us near. Verse 2. In you there is a vision. In you we learn to dream. When all we see is desert, may you be our living stream. In you there is a future. In you we find our way. When hope has shed its brightness, may you show us a new day.
Going to be great when you stand for that. And I'd like to do one more, just more voices 107, which is God Loves Me, which is our children's song for today. The words go by quite quickly in this one. God loves me, for my God is love, divine love. Divine love, God protects me, God is great. God loves me, for my God is love, divine love. God protects me, God is great. We'll probably sing that two or three times as the children leave. Thank you.
And thank you, Kelly. We're delighted to have some snowbirds starting to appear already, and our choir's got something special planned later on the 21st in the later afternoon.
Yes.
And you'll get to hear more about that next week. So welcome to the snowbirds, welcome to those joining us through live stream, and we want to say a special greetings to Edna Sparks. Edna is recently here in Victoria and worshiping with us now. But for 60 years, when she lived in the Peace River area, she was for 60 years the church organist. So I think that's pretty close to a record, and she just recently celebrated her 90th birthday. So congratulations to you. Now, where are you here? You're right nearby here? Congratulations. There you are. Welcome. Hope you can join us for the lunch today, and others can express their greetings to you. David is now going to come and light the Christ candle as we remember that Christ indeed is in our midst, the one who invites us to let our light shine as well. Thank you, David. And we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught. Our Father, our Mother,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not.
One of our youth now leads us in the invitation to worship.
Let us go up on the mountain.
Let's go up to the place where the land meets the sky, where the earth touches the heavens.
To the place of meeting.
To the place of this.
To the place of voices and conversations.
To the place of listening.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Now, today we are celebrating Mardi Gras. Unfortunately, it's a long weekend, so many families are away. But actually, Mardi Gras comes before Lent, so we cannot change the order. So anyway, we're going to have Mardi Gras, and I'll see what we have here. Oh, yes, those Mardi Gras. So each one of you children, you're going to have those things. And let's see, open. Wow, those, like I have here. And we're going to have fun time. We have, of course, crafts, fish ponds, and maybe you can be back today. You're going to watch the video, so maybe you can be back today. You're going to, I wanted to make sure you can watch the video here. So, okay, so anyway, we're going to have fun and going to have chili today. It's a wonderful chili made by Kathy McMillan and Misha Canslop and some of the youth chopping things, and they worked on Friday. So it'll be very delicious. So games and a bouncy castle and a fish pond and making masks. If some of you want to be children, you can join us too. So that's when. But today we wanted to show you something because this is whole year 2015 is over. I wanted to share with you kind of called annual report. So where some of you like to come here, that's good, but just watch that one, okay, that screen. So before I'm going to show you, let's say all together, God is good.
All the time.
All the time?
God is good.
Good. So here starts, okay, I hope this one works. Let's see. Yes. Yes. Ah, worked. I have to learn, not this way, but that way. Okay, so you can see what happened 2015. It's kind of like annual report, but annual report written, we have here pictures. Wow, this is January, what happened there? It's Epiphany, we had a Roger Nakashima, we enjoyed. You can see junior youth, they're making cookies or whatever class. And then some of you, all of you have, I hope, you have prayer patch. February, while Martin Brockenleg, he was here and he did the children's time. And we had a family potluck. Well, February is a busy time, and you can see youth there, and they made soup and vegetables for out of the rain shelter. That's usually they do on Tuesday, on February. And you can see the funny picture. Can you read as a Cuba, C-U-B-A, Cuba preparation meeting? And then, of course, Mardi Gras. And we have here pancake people are making, and the children's choir is singing. And can you see you? And the right side bottom, that is, it was our mission theme about Sudan's youth. Now, next one is March. Guess what? Where is it? Cuba. Cuba trip, Cuba mission exposure trip. And then March here, we had Labyrinth. And you can see their children have quiet time to pray and learn. And then also we had a Palm Sunday. Usually Palm Sunday, there's a Holy Week drama. What's next? April, Easter. And here's Earth and Peace Walk. And it's a camping Sunday we had, and there was a new director, Akazia, and Sarah, they are showing, and you can see some of you are there, right? Now, May already, and May there's a youth retreat, and Mother's Day from Shizuoka Ewa students. They usually come Mother's Day, about 80 to 100 students from Japan. It's a Christian school. And then, you know, that's a day really, really interesting happens. Counters means the people who count money. Some of them are sitting there. They said, oh my goodness, there's lots of $5 bills. Probably 100 of them. If there are 100 people, there's $500 there for brand new crisp $5 bills, because they are learning how to do the offering. And so the old student, they bring that. So it's a very, they have a wonderful singing here, sharing with us. And May here, again, we had a turkey dinner, a spring turkey dinner, and then Pentecost. And June, can you see some of you there? Very tiny, tiny. We had a very, very special service. It's called the United Church's 90th anniversary. So very much intergenerational. We talked about how about United Church 90s. We had a Bud Bakken. He just turned 90. He was talking about when he was young and when he was at Sunday school. And you can see we had a youth talking about church and future. And also we had a retired ministers talking about the United Church. Do you remember how many of you were there that Sunday? You remember that Sunday? It was lots of balloons. And then June, of course, our famous congregational camp. It's, I think it was the 13th year. So this coming year will be 14th year. And here, all those activities, right side there, you can see two people. They are the one graduates from high school. And, Sam and Gwyneth. And also, Sarah Prestwich graduated from university too. And July is Sabbath time, quiet time. And August, you can see here, Hiroshima's 70th anniversary. So we joined to Raging Grannies for the ceremony. And a legacy lunch, you can see all the youth. They're learning how to cook and how to serve. Some of you see there, this is August. The summer day camps. How many of you were at the summer day camps? Yes. And for the leaders too. And what's next? Here, summer day camp and youth conference. And September, we had a rally Sunday. Here you see, and fish pond. And of course, we're going to have a fish pond today too. And here's rally Sunday, and bouncy castles. And we had Alison Reese, yay! Alison Reese for parenting. October, family fun, again, a new form. And we had a Thanksgiving here. We took the staff to our place. And November, again, our turkey dinner there. And we have a wonderful Curvers. Can you see right side bottom? They are the regulars of Curvers. Thank you so much, Curving. And November Children's Sunday. You can see youth, they are sitting there, discussion there happening. And they were talking about refugees. And in November again, so a children's choir and a baptism and Advent event for the craft. And December, we had a December 6th community service. And it was a wonderful, and this year focus was murdered and missing women. And white gift service, some of you are there. And here's another white gift service. And then another one. And then Christmas Eve, there were two services, 4:30 and 11 o'clock, we were involved. But of course, there was a 7:30 service too. How many of you are one of those Christmas services?
I
know. Yeah, how many of you are there? Some of you are away. Good, good. So this is just what happened from 2015. Our church, particular events, you know, this is just only surface. Every Sunday, very, very faithful Sunday school teachers, they are working for all of us. And maybe we can talk that one later. So I wanted you to see what happened last year very quickly. And we're going to have Mardi Gras. And make sure we're going to have a camp in June so they can start to prepare. And the camp theme is going to be Christmas. Have Christmas in June. Hope all of you can come. So thank you. And we're going to sing God is Love song. And we're going to the Sunday school.
Can we wait that first? Okay. Thank you.
Hebrew scripture is Luke chapter 9 verses 28 to 36. Now about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up on the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things they had seen.
And we join in a response to that reading. O God, we open our eyes and we see Jesus. The months of ministry transfigured to a beam of light, the light of the world, your light.
May your light shine upon us.
We open our eyes and see Moses and Elijah, your word restoring us, showing us the way, telling a story, your story, his story, our story. We open our eyes and we see mist, the cloud of your presence, which assures us of all we do not know, and that we do not need to fear that.
Teach us to trust.
We open our eyes and we see Peter's constructions, his best plans, our best plans, are missing the point, are missing the way. We open our eyes and we see Jesus, not casting us off, but leading us down, leading us out. We open our ears and we hear your voice. This is my beloved child. Listen to him. This is part of our story. He was executed in a Nazi prison just days before the end of the war. But ever since, the Christian theologian and martyr Dietrich Bonhoeffer continues to speak to us. Last April marked the 70th anniversary of his death, and Bonhoeffer's works, his books, were reissued by SEM Press. In London, England, to mark the occasion, SEM Press teamed up with St. Martin's in the Fields to put on a special event that featured several key theologians. They each had been asked to reflect upon something that Bonhoeffer had written and about its impact and significance for the church today. I myself was most fortunate to attend that event, and I was particularly impressed by a presentation given by a professor in a seminary in London by the name of Jane Williams. From his Nazi prison cell, Dietrich Bonhoeffer had written the following words: "We have been silent witnesses of evil deeds. Intolerable conflicts have worn us down and made us cynical. Are we still of any use? What we shall need is not geniuses or cynics or misanthropes or clever tacticians, but plain, honest, straightforward people." This is the quote that was the focus for Dr. Williams' presentation, a message I want to share with you today. So, to be clear, from here on, you're going to hear my voice, but these are the words of Professor Williams. "Let us begin," Jane Williams says to us, "by noting the context of Bonhoeffer's writings, a church that is so clearly flawed." He was able to see the flaws with a clarity that we sometimes fail to bring to our own church life. Because clearly, Bonhoeffer is speaking from a place where there was no denying the failure of the church and its leadership. His church and its culture failed to withstand evil. And so when he is writing these words from his prison cell about what we shall need, he sees clearly the two great temptations that human beings are faced with in the church that is failing. Although clearly our society is nothing like Nazi Germany, it's very interesting to see these two temptations being played out again and again in our society and in our church. The first temptation: to assume that we can fix things by being very clever. Bonhoeffer says the temptation is to presume geniuses will solve all our problems, to assume that this is what leadership must offer, clever tactics. The second temptation: to give up, to opt out, to assume that nothing can be done. The temptation of leadership to think that the problems of church and society are too difficult to fix. Bonhoeffer's cynics and misanthropes, that is, people who hate. What Bonhoeffer argues in the face of those two temptations is that what we actually need to face them is plain, honest, straightforward people. What does Bonhoeffer mean by that? It sounds almost naive and simplistic until you go on to the next part of his writing. He goes on to ask, "Will our inward power of resistance be strong enough, and our honesty with ourselves be remorseless enough for us to find our way back to simplicity and straightforwardness?" The plain, honest straightforwardness that Bonhoeffer is talking about is something that only can be won through discipline. It's not inbuilt, not a naive, simple acceptance of ourselves as we are. It reminds me of when T.S. Eliot writes about receiving a condition of simplicity costing no less than everything. That's the kind of straightforwardness Bonhoeffer is talking about. Something that is going to cost. So to train leaders for a flawed church, Bonhoeffer argues, is to train them to be honest and straightforward. How are you going to do that? Well, in theory, this kind of straightforwardness, this kind of honesty, is something Christianity is well equipped to teach. For we believe that we are given our value by the God who loves us without condition. So there's no need for genius or tactics. We believe that this God grows hope in the most unlikely places, even the cross and the grave, so that cynicism and hatred is short-sighted when we are dealing with the God who raised Jesus from the dead. And what's more, the Christian tradition has tools to teach us: remorseless honesty and the power of resistance. The things Bonhoeffer thinks we need if we are to get back to that simplicity and straightforwardness. And Christianity offers that most basic discipline called prayer. There is no avoiding the absolute presence of God in true prayer. I don't know if you have noticed, but you can't lie to God. There's no point in trying to lie to God, because you cannot deceive God. You cannot win God over to your side. You can't persuade God to see things strictly from your point of view. So when you truly pray, honesty is forced upon you, like it or not. It's forced upon us by the simple, straightforward process of being in the presence of the one who knows us absolutely. And God's honesty in that relationship is remorseless, pitiless, you could even say hard-hearted. Yet it is also in that presence alone that we find ourselves truly and fully loved, truly and fully set free. Because there is no need for any pretense of any kind. Most of us need our leaders to help us to be in that presence. We need that kind of help given by leaders who know how to be in that place. We need the help of a praying community. We need leaders who will tell us that straightforward story that makes this community, the story we find in the Bible and the sacraments, the story we tell by confessing to each other and receiving forgiveness from one another. Just the plain, straightforward bread and butter of the Christian discipline. But the problem is that a lot of us, at a lot of the time, find it very hard to believe that the most important thing for us to do is to pray. We find it hard to believe that this is what we should be most looking for in our church leaders, both clergy and lay. Instead, our leaders are tempted, because we ask it of them, to offer us cleverness or bright ideas or goodwill or attractiveness. None of them bad, all of them valuable, but all of them likely to fail us in a crisis, as Bonhoeffer saw, unless they have been forged deep and strong in the depths of that honest gaze of God who sees us as we are. What we need, then, is leaders who stand daily in that gaze and can take us with them without fear. One of my favorite pieces of writing is a letter from Evelyn Underhill, a great writer on mysticism. She wrote it in 1930, addressed to the Archbishop of Canterbury, and she was urging that the most important thing that an upcoming conference should do was to encourage the clergy and lay leaders to cultivate their prayer lives. She pointed out that the vague goodwill that many church leaders offer just won't hack it. And that is why, and this is Jane continuing, this is why I absolutely love this phrase of Underhill's, and I take it everywhere I go. God is the interesting thing about religion. God is the interesting thing about religion, and people are hungry for God. If she is right, and surely she is, then anything else we offer less than God will not be enough. But also, we can only offer what we ourselves have imbibed. We cannot offer God to people if God is not an acquaintance of ours at the very least. And only God transforms. We can go on rearranging the furniture indefinitely, but only God calls life out of nothing. So if we want leaders that can lead us to the truth and lead us to the reality of our calling to offer God's true help and sustenance to the world, this is all we've got. God. But practicing that belief, living out that belief, is a lifetime discipline. So what I find particularly helpful and challenging about Bonhoeffer's statement in this context is that it makes it so clear, so very clear, that this call to prayer is not a cop-out. It's not a retreat to a safe spirituality of interiority, but a hard slog to be truthful. So that under all circumstances, even the circumstances of Nazi Germany, under all circumstances, whether we have time to think or only time to react, under all circumstances, we do so from the place where we have grown, that place of honesty, where we have been truly seen and loved. So yes, that's the kind of leadership that a flawed church needs. Flawed, human, straightforward leadership that depends on God. It looks like people who are honest enough to say that we only have this one thing to offer. Nothing particularly of our own, none of our personal qualities, just God. People who can only say that because they have spent a lot of time on their knees, doing the bread and butter work of the church, which is simply to make space for God. On this Transfiguration Sunday, as we give thanks for the leadership of Jesus and the first disciples, as we celebrate the leadership of countless volunteers within this congregation, may we reflect upon these words of Bonhoeffer and of Jane Williams. And let me share with you a prayer that Bonhoeffer would pray each morning in his prison cell, his morning prayer. Let us pray. O God, early in the morning I cry to you. Help me to pray and to concentrate my thoughts on you. I cannot do this alone. In me there is a darkness, but with you there is light. I am lonely, but you do not leave me. I am feeble in heart, but with you there is help. I am restless, but with you there is peace. In me there is bitterness, but with you there is patience. I do not understand your ways, but you know the best way for me. Restore me to liberty. Enable me to live now that I may answer before you and before myself. Lord, whatever this day may bring, your name be praised. Amen. Written from Tegel Prison by Dietrich Bonhoeffer. As we continue to reflect upon these words, let us join in song. Friends, we have a special part of our service today, and I'm going to invite Clarice Dillman to join Tammy at this point. Clarice is chair of our council, and today we want to celebrate some of the leadership that is present here in First Metropolitan. We note that we made plans and then discovered a long weekend, so that some are away, and we'll find ways to honor them as well. And also there's a few positions yet to be ratified by our council, so we'll include those folks later on as well. But to begin with, we focus on the scripture saying, there are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit gives them. There are different ways of serving, but the same God is served. Friends, volunteers are the very heart of the life and mission here at First Metropolitan. And so today we welcome and recognize those who have agreed to be new members of various committees. And as their names are read now by Clarice, we would ask that those who are present to come forward and just stand here at the front for a moment.
I'm Clarice Dillman and I'm chair of council. It is my pleasure to share with you that we do have new volunteers and what a gift they are in a congregation of our size because we have so much to do. So I'm going to read out the following names, and as Alan said, if you'd come forward, that would be great. Jean Jenkins, she is our council secretary. Now, if you don't think that is a big job, just give it a try. Barbara Langton, she is the secretary of our council executive, and she blessed us with serving as secretary for council for a few months, and we thank her so much for that.
And Barbara does the fine thing of setting an example of being at both worship services. If you can come and join us.
Marva Smith is a new volunteer with CYYAF. Yes. Barbara Whitney is a new volunteer with Newcomers. Vreeni Mathias is a new volunteer with Spiritual Care and Wellness, and she is also on our Health and Wellness Review Team. Andrea Hoffmeyer is a new volunteer with Outreach. Paul Henderson is a new volunteer with CYYAF. Kenneth McCallum is a new volunteer with our Music Advisory Committee. Tim Richards is a new volunteer with our M&P Committee. Jan Drant is a new committee member with Outreach and Adult Shelter Liaison. Joan Mickelson is a new committee member on Music Advisory. Vicki Atwell is a new volunteer on Hospitality. Margaret Query, CSD in Worship, and she is responsible with help for our wonderful flowers, and we really love them every Sunday. John Newhouse, he has taken on a huge job of chair of the Lead Minister Review Team, and we so appreciate that commitment. David Bray is a new member of the Redevelopment Task Group. Marie McKee is new as a member of M&P Committee. Adina Malcolm is new on Council Exec, and we're ecstatic to have her. Andrew Swan is a new member of Trustees, and Joan Mason is new as the chair of the Music Advisory Committee. So I'm going to welcome each of them, and I would ask you to do the same.
Thanks to them all.
We give thanks that you have agreed to share your time and talent in the life and mission of First Metropolitan United Church. As a sign of affirmation and support on behalf of the congregation, we have greeted you this day. Welcome to the opportunities and the responsibilities of this calling.
And so we celebrate your coming forward, and we know that there are many others who have your own way of volunteering quietly in the background. Thanks for your support as well. But today we also want to recognize the special giving of much time and talent for all those who are serving as a chair of one of our committees or task groups or in some similar fashion. And so as the names are read, those who are present again, we would ask if you would come forward and come and join us as the other group did. Clarice Stillman, the chair of council. And extensive work any time in that role, but especially in a season of transition. Our past chair of council is Andrea Swan, returning from France in a few weeks' time. Our chair of archives and archivist is Marjorie Hadley, and there's a good deal of work being done in that area right now. Our co-chairs of Christian Spiritual Development and Worship, Adina Malcolm and Marion Denton, they come forward. And so not only for the Sunday worships at 9:11, but other special worships like our Celtic Vespers, what we had on Friday, and our various spiritual growth opportunities of different programs are under this committee. Our children, youth, young adults, and families are co-chaired by Kat Rainsbury and Lorna Pritchard, who aren't usually here at this time in the service because they're helping out with Sunday school most Sundays. Our chair of Epiphany Explorations is Lisa Zala. Our chair of Hospitality is Myra Nassim. And that's good. I didn't know if you'd be here or in the kitchen just right now, Myra. Good. We know what a gift hospitality is for this congregation and a key role she plays in it. Chair of Library, Denise Holman. We're fortunate to have someone with that background serving in that role for us. I know she's up in the balcony, but will join us and was helping our youth with some books today. Joan Mason is away at the time, but is the chair of our Music Advisory Committee. Janet Gray, likewise away, but chair of our Outreach Committee, which has extensive functions, as you know. Chair of Spiritual Care and Wellness is Tom Attic. And just last week, we got a sense of the diverse range of programs that are offered in this area, not to mention the type of pastoral visiting being done both by ministry and volunteer folk. Our co-chairs of the UCW, United Church Women, those are Joan Douse and Marie McKee. Our chair of trustees, Ken Johnson. Our chair of finance and our treasurer, Leanne Clark. Chair of property is Larry McGill. And you can imagine that entails a lot of involvement. And our chair of our volunteer coordinator is Irene Badley. And Irene comes from an extensive background with the Y in volunteer at works, and we're delighted that she's used those gifts for our church here. Al Fowler is acting as a liaison for us from Presbytery and is a co-chair of our communications and IT. And I should note that Clarice also is co-chair of that committee of communications and IT. I'm checking my trifocals here, folks. I want to make sure we have everyone included here. We have our task groups, and the people acting in that, Ross Brecken has been our chair, and we're delighted. We're waiting for a verification, but Paul Jenkins already has been a great help to us. So Paul, hang on for a week or two, and we hope to have your here as well. Our transition task group, I invite Leanne is here already, but she can be a representative of that group, along with her hat as treasurer. Our lead minister review team, John Newhouse, who was up here a moment ago. We invite you back, John. Our health and wellness chair is task group chair is Tom Attic, and Kathy Wallace is chair convener for children, youth, young and adults and family task group. So to all of these people, we say our thanks. And Tammy.
And because of wonderful trifolds, Alan, I would also like to thank Leanne Prestwich, who couldn't be with us today because she's working. In serving as chairs of committees, we recognize that many extra hours and commitments that you offer as a part of that, and so wonderfully offer. A sign of our appreciation for this over and above commitment, we wish to present you each with a prayer scarf. And may you know our prayers are always with you.
We're going to give folks the opportunity to change them if they're not quite right, because we've learned from our prayer squares it's very important to get just the right one.
Maybe a couple more just in case. Come over here, John.
Color.
Oh, good. We got that one there.
Thank you.
And while you remain standing there, if you would, for a moment, all our chairs and others, along with these prayer scarves, we would like to offer a special commissioning to you this day in work that you have already taken on and continue to do so. And so receive this commissioning now. May the fire of the Spirit inspire your soul. May the wisdom of Christ guide all your thoughts and decisions. And may you join with Jesus in humility and service, using the position entrusted to you for the benefit of all. God bless your eyes to see clearly. God bless your ears to listen intently. God bless your mouth to speak honestly, offering words of encouragement and inspiration. God bless your hands in reaching out to others. God bless your feet to walk in the way of Christ. And in all seasons and circumstances, may the deep peace of the Spirit be yours, keeping you well grounded and centered and whole. Amen. Peace be with you all.
On behalf of everyone here, we'd like to say a special thank you to the knitters. They have done a wonderful job once again, and it's a very thoughtful gift that you've given us. Thank you.
So the people who have come forward have already given something of an offering of their time and talent. And we continue in our worship now as we present our offering in this morning.
Please be seated. Let us join our hearts in prayer. Sacred Mystery, thank you for the gift of this day. We thank you for the gift of life that is born new every morning. We get a chance to start again. Particularly this day, we're grateful for your work within this congregation and within our lives. May you help us to create a gentle and beautiful community that finds ways to correct and challenge each other and love and encourage. And with a community filled with volunteers, both past and present, we saw witness to those who give of their hearts, their lives, and their money. And we know that each time someone gives of their muscle, mind, and money, both past and present, that we are encouraged and strengthened as a community of faith. We know to be a volunteer in any capacity, it takes a generosity, a willingness to give time and resources and our care to others. And thankfully, that helps us to live with generosity of spirit that reflects your love in this sometimes very weary world. As a volunteer, we know it takes understanding, because the lives and opinions of those we are involved with might be very different from our own. Thankfully, that challenges us to live outside our own comfort zones on occasion. It is always good to practice trying to see things in a new way. It enlivens us to the possibilities beyond our own limited vision. God, we know to be a volunteer, it takes empathy, an ability to put ourselves in someone else's shoes and feel what they must feel. And thankfully, that allows us to truly listen with our whole heart, bringing us to a deeper sense of the other in our midst. We know that it takes compassion to truly care about making someone else's life better. Thankfully, that inspires us to action, to take care of those who are displaced or without proper housing or basic needs being met, those who are hurt or sick, those who are lifted up by Amnesty International, such as the woman in Vietnam who's a human rights activist. She's very ill in prison and yet being denied health care. We lift her in our prayers. We pray for the families Margaret Cunningham and Ruth Mannix, that you hold them in your tender care. We also have in our prayers this day Bill Walker, Laura Butler, Sven Jensen, and Tom Main. And God, we know to be a volunteer, we need patience, because the process doesn't always go as smoothly as it might. Thankfully, it's patience that gets us through, trusting that you are our constant companion in our life journey, both as individuals and as a community. You've shown us these qualities through Jesus and so much more, so thank you. Help us to be generous, understanding, empathetic, compassionate, patient people. Most of all, help us to be plain, honest, and straightforward, that we might always reflect you in our lives. Amen.
Spirit, to this I am called. And so at the end of our service, we are invited to join us for our lunch in the fellowship hall. And a reminder to our committee members, we return to room 119, the Doreen McLeod room, for our workshop starts at 1 o'clock sharp. And now receive this blessing. God above you, God below you, God behind you, God before you, God to your left, God to your right, God in the eye that sees you, God in the face that welcomes you. The peace of God be with you this day and evermore. Amen.
Okay.